Greetings and welcome to Astronomy at Hack. The purpose of this video is to go through the one of the early activities, the scientific methods activities that we'll be doing in this class, and to go through and explain it as I would in a traditional class. At the beginning of the lab activity, I would go through and explain a little bit about what you're going to be doing, and I'll be doing the same thing here in this video for my online classes. So the first part of the activity, as we look at it here, I'll bring it up on the screen, actually shows a spectrum. We call a spectrum here, and that's just a set of spectral lines that we see. And that's these lines here that you see that are purple, blue, green, yellow, orange, red, and then infrared. So we see all those different lines there. And what you're going to do is to answer six questions based on these. The first question says, what are the estimated wavelength measurements? This is a very easy portion. All you do is take the scale that's given here, 400 nanometers, 500 nanometers, 600, and 700, and estimate on your answer sheet where each of those lines falls. So there's seven different lines. You'll have seven different numbers. Be sure to give them as a number somewhere between a little under 400 and a little over 700 nanometers, and make sure you give the units for that measurement. Make sure anytime you give a number, there should be a unit attached to it. So in this case, if you were looking, for example, at green, you might estimate it to be around 510 nanometers. If you don't put the unit there, it is not correct. Now that's the first question. You do that for each of those seven lines and record them on there. There's no other measurement involved at this point. Now the second question involves asking about the uncertainty. How certain are you about your answers? So what you would do here is determine how far off you can be. So for example, if you think that green is 510 nanometers and someone else told you that it is 515 and you couldn't argue that significantly, you wouldn't feel comfortable arguing, you say, well, maybe you're right, maybe it is really 515, then your errors would be about 5 nanometers. So if you think it's 510, but it could go between 505 and 515, your error would be about 5 nanometers. You only need one error estimate for all of these. So in general, do you think you're on average, you are off by 5 nanometers, 3 nanometers, 10 nanometers, or 100 nanometers? How far off do you think that you are? Number three asks you just how could you make your answer more precise? What could you do to make this a more accurate answer? So give me your answer for that. Now number four asks you to actually measure a couple of these, to measure the distances between three specific pairs of lines. In this case, you're going to be looking at the yellow and the red, and then the blue and the red lines. You're going to look at the distances. You're going to need a ruler to measure that, and it will need to be a metric ruler because you have to measure it in centimeters or millimeters. So you would want to measure the difference first between the blue line and the yellow line. So how far apart are those two? Here, blue to yellow, you'll want to measure that. You'll want to measure the yellow then to the red. And then finally, the big one would be the blue to the red. So you're going to measure those three distances. I need the measurements, and I need an estimate of your uncertainty. Again, how far off do you think this might be? So if you measured the distance to, say, 2.4 centimeters, well, let's make it 2.9 centimeters, plus or minus, maybe you think you're to within 1 millimeter. So 2.9 plus or minus 0.1 centimeters. How far off do you think you might be? Maybe I think I'm a tenth of a centimeter off, and that's how I would write those answers. Don't just write 2.9 centimeters. None of these measurements can be perfect. There has to be some measurement of the error. Now, number five asks you to calculate the scale factor. So what we're going to do there is calculate the plate scale of this image. And you can do that by using the measurements you've already made. So you don't have to do any more measurements for this. You just have to use what you've already determined. So as an example, let's pick out two lines here. Let's pick out the red and the infrared, for example. If you estimate the infrared to be at, say, 720 nanometers, and the red to be at about 660 nanometers, your first step is to subtract those two and find what the difference is between them. In this case, if you subtract them, you'll get 60 nanometers. Now you have to measure the distance between them. And let's just say on your scale that it happened to be 6 centimeters. So if you measure the distance that what you did from part four, you take those measurements and then you will then divide. You will take the estimated distances from part one, in this case about 60 nanometers, divide it by, say, 6 centimeters if that's what you measured, and get that the scale factor is 10 nanometers per centimeter. That would be your answer for one of them. You would do that for all three that I ask you to do, the blue and the yellow and the red, and the blue and the red lines. You will get three different scale factors. You want to include both of those. Plus, you want to average the results together. That just means take the three values you get, add them up, and divide it by three, and give your scale factor. And again, don't forget the units. Now, finally, the last section here is to compare with a lab partner. In an online class, we don't have lab partners, but I do have a discussion board that is set up for this that you can access through the lab module. So you will want to do that. You will need to post your average result and post that on the discussion board. That will be something I will be looking for in grading this assignment. If you did not post, you will not get any credit for question six if you do not make a posting on there. Other students will have posted. You can use those to then compare and see how well you might have done. So that's kind of one of the beginning part that may be a little bit confusing in some cases. Let's look at the rest of this. I want to talk about a couple of things just briefly. I want to talk about measurement errors. What do we mean by a measurement error? Well, there are differences in how you can measure things. Some things we count. If we have a dozen eggs, we can sit there and count them and find out that there are 12. And everybody is going to count them and everybody's going to get the same answer because that is an exact number. In the measurements that we did previously, we are making measurements. So if you're measuring a board, you might get 1.25 meters long. Someone else might measure it at 1.24, someone at 1.28 meters. So the measurements might be a little bit different. You could average them together to get a better value of the measurement. But that's what we mean when we say that all measurements are estimations. And as I told you in the previous slide, you always express those with an error estimate. So if you're making a measurement, you want to include an estimate of how far off you think you might be. So if you estimate it to be, 1.2 meters plus or minus a tenth of a meter, that would be the way you would express it as an error in terms of an error estimate. Now, on the next section, there's a couple other things that we're going to be looking at in this lab. Oops, go back one here. All right. We're going to look at accuracy versus precision. And what I mean by accuracy is that if you're being accurate, you are getting close to the target. You're hitting the center where you're supposed to get. You're getting close, in that case, to the actual value or the accepted value. Precision means you're being consistent. You might be making the measurements over and over, and you're consistently getting the same value, but it's off. So those are two examples, and what you can means is that you can make measurements with high accuracy. You're getting the right value, but your precision is low, meaning that your values are all over the place around the correct answer. You're getting on the general region of the correct answer, but you're all over the place. You're scattered around it quite a bit. You can also have the opposite. You can have low accuracy with high precision. You can be getting the wrong answer, but you're consistently getting that answer every single time. Often that shows that there might be some kind of systematic error in your measurements. Now, for this activity, what you're looking at is something very similar to this, and this slide will show you precision versus accuracy. So that high precision increases as you go from the bottom to the top here, and the accuracy increases as you go from left to right. So precision is low down here, so low precision. This would be high precision. And this is low accuracy. and high accuracy. So what you want, what you see then is, you know, depending on where you fall on the scale, I'm going to give you a couple targets in your assignment to be able to look at to get your answers for it. But you're only going to be answering whether they're high or low. Accuracy and precision is all you have to mention on it. That's all I need for that section. So that'll be the second section of the lab. The third section has to do with significant figures. Now, I wanted to describe these a little bit, tell you a little bit about what significant figures are, because measurements are only an estimate, any calculations we do with them are limited. So look at my example here. You measure the distance between two points to be 150 kilometers. You travel that distance in 7 hours. Well, if you just plug those numbers into your calculator, you'd find that your speed was 21.4285714 kilometers per hour. Well, that's wrong. That's not correct, and it's only correct if it is precisely 150 kilometers, not a centimeter more or a centimeter less, and the time is precisely 7 hours, not 6 hours and 58 minutes, or 7 hours and 5 minutes. The measurements are only approximate. So if you do this correctly, 150 kilometers has two significant figures. Dividing that by 7 hours, one significant figure, gives us 20 kilometers per hour, which is a reasonable estimate of the speed traveled based on the numbers that we were given. So you always have to look at that when you are doing calculations, because we need to look at how many significant figures an object has, and your calculator just does a direct calculation. It does not give you any information about significant figures. You have to put that in yourself. Now, helpful, you may find this helpful for determining if a number is significant. You can use the flowchart here if you're unsure, and you start at the top and work your way through it. So what we'd find is you'd pick your number. Your number is a 0 through a 9. It's got to be one of those. If it's a non-zero number, it's always significant. So you're already done there, always significant. You know that is a significant number. If it is 0, then you have to look at, is it at the front of the number? Is there nothing else non-zero before it, in which case it is never significant? Is it between other non-zero digits, in which case it's always significant? Or is it at the end of the number, in which case, if it contains a decimal point, it's significant, and if it does not contain a decimal point, it is not significant. So if you use this, and I'm going to go through some examples on the next slide, that will always tell you whether a number is, whether a letter, a digit is significant or not. So if we look at the next slide with a few examples here, all of these numbers at the beginning here, this very first section, all of these are the same number of significant figures. Every single one of these has two significant figures, or two sig figs. So two significant figures. Because if you look at the rules from the previous page and apply them here, every single one of these will come up with two significant figures. The one that I didn't really mention was the scientific notation here. In scientific notation, you only look at the number of digits to the left of the power of 10. That's all that matters. The rest of this does not matter in determining the significant figures. When we look at the others here, this one will have five significant figures. Remember that zeros before the zeros starting the number are never significant, so these are not significant at all. The one and the five will be significant, and those at the end are significant because there is a decimal point in the number. So this would have five significant figures. This one would also have five. Again, you start with the one, that's significant, and the zeros do count because there is a decimal point. So this would have five significant figures. And the last one would actually have six, because again, the one and the five are automatically significant, and the ones to the right count because there is a decimal point there. So in that case, you would have six significant figures. Now, one of the other things, the last section of this activity will have you do some calculations with significant figures. So we want to look at those as well briefly. And what we have for calculations with significant figures, a couple things to remember. First of all, you hopefully know order of operations. You've seen that before. You always do parentheses first, then anything that is raised to a power, multiply and divide, and finally you add and subtract. When you multiply and divide, your final answer cannot have more significant figures than the input number that had the least number of significant figures. What does that mean? Well, let's look at an example here. We take 385.26, which would have 5 significant figures. We take 12.2, which has 3, and 13.85, which has 4. So 3, 4, and 5, when we put those in our calculator, we get 339.362599. But we cannot have more significant figures than the least here, which was 3, meaning that we have to round this to 3 significant figures, and your answer would be 339. It's a little bit different if you're adding or subtracting. In addition or subtraction, the final answer cannot go past the place of the least significant digit. What does that mean? Well, let's look at an example again. This example, we add 258.145, we add 1.2, and then we subtract 13.8756. Well, this one goes to the thousandths place, this one to the tenths, and this one to the 10,000th place. When you add or subtract, you've got to look at the least place, which in this case would be the tenths, which is going to limit your answer. You're going to have to limit it at the tenths because we do not know anything about the hundredths in this number or the thousandths or the 10,000ths, so we can't have anything more significant in the answer. When we add it up, we get 245.4694, and for significant figures, we would then stop at the tenth place and round it off to 245.5. So those are just a few examples of the types of calculations that you'll need to do for this lab activity. Just to kind of summarize here, just what we looked at in terms of the scientific method, in terms of making measurements and measurement errors, and always including units and the measurement error if you're making a measurement. We talked about accuracy and precision as to what the difference is between something being accurate and it being precise. We looked at significant figures and how you determine them. Use that flowchart if you need to determine whether a figure is significant or not. And then we looked at calculations with significant figures. And you will be doing some of those with this exercise. So that concludes this video explaining the scientific methods activity. And until next time, have a great day, everyone. And I will see you in class.